This is the digital revolution. We're here on behalf of the Commonwealth Broadcasting Association to look at what the challenges, opportunities, threats are presented by the rise of social media, its impact on society, as well as the migration to digital television in a few years' time. As countries in this region, in East Africa, prepare for that, what does it mean? How will it change how we as journalists and media people work? How does that affect how users and audiences consume content? Well, with me for that discussion, I've got a distinguished panel of media experts from around East Africa. We've got Maria Sarungi. She is the chairperson of the Tanzania Independent Producers Association. We've also got Vivien Marles, who's the managing director of InterMedia. She's here to speak on behalf of the audiences. She is an audience research expert. And a man we all know, Salim Amin, who's the chairman of A24 Media, also joining us. And from the Nation Media Group, the online editor, Churchill Otieno, is also joining us on this discussion. And all the way from Kampala in Uganda is Rachel. Rachel Mugarura-Mutana was the former editor-in-chief of Uganda Radio Network. She's a practicing journalist, a blogger. So we've got the whole media landscape covered. Once upon a time, long, long time ago, this kind of things existed. Where I lived, not far from Nairobi, we didn't have individual phone numbers. We all had, a whole neighborhood would have numbers that were identical, X27Y. And we were all put on one line by the telecom supplier. So when the phone rings in your house, it's also ringing on the neighbors because the number is the same. So you'd pick up and the operator said, "Not you, Mrs. Mwangi," put down, "Not you, Simon," and you know, because we all shared a number, the same number. And we used things that look like this, which don't exist anymore. We're in a museum, so this is where this has come from. How life has changed. and now, that onto this, where I live my life, my Facebook, where I find out who's marrying who, who's divorcing who, who's died, who's been born, Twitter, where I'm told what's happening in my neighborhood, whatever is happening in the region. And I've also got my banking all here. I get messages from my bank on my digital platform here telling me that you're withdrawing money that doesn't belong to you because I've gone overdrawn. So that's how life has changed. The digital revolution is here. We followed the news from the Arab world with the Arab Spring and the political ramifications that that has had. So what about our region? What about Africa? How ready are we in East Africa for this digital revolution as we migrate from analog to a digital television in a few years' time? How will social media impact our lives and how we live as audiences? Well, that's a question I'd like to throw to my panel.
I think there's a lot of opportunity. What I've seen is an enormous amount of opportunity where we have the ability to tell our stories through so many different mediums of communication. In the past, we were restrained by just the television set, by the broadcaster. Now we can use the internet, we can use YouTube, we can use social media to send out those stories. We can reach a much wider audience than we've ever been able to reach before. The people that are posting that information are not necessarily journalists that have been trained to fact check and to do their research and to check their sources. And
this, because I think, effectively is everyone is a content.
Everybody has become a journalist. Everybody sitting here is in effect a journalist. But who is checking their stuff? How many of them have been trained to go and double and triple check sources? That is something that I'm very scared of. I think that's a huge challenge in terms of who believes what and how do you control that.
Churchill, you're the online editor for Nation Media Group. You're interacting with that other part of the world, people who come to you online. Are we creating this threat? Is that side of the business really growing?
My answer is an emphatic yes. What digital has done is that it has taken power, it has wrenched that power from us and taken it back to the audience so that the people whose stories we used to tell now have fairly easy chance to tell that story themselves. So for us in the mainstream media and in the what you call traditional media, we have no choice but to accept that reality and to find out how then do we change our game to make sure that we remain relevant to that huge audience.
We'll come to how we adapt to these changes in a moment. Let me turn to you, Rachel. What are the challenges as you see it for yourself as a journalist and for the Ugandan media?
Okay. I think the major challenge is hearing the voices that exist out there in the social media. Traditional media is used to telling us what the agenda is, setting the agenda, telling us who is important to tell a news story. Now, many people are contributing their own stories out there on Facebook, on Twitter, and other social media platforms. The traditional media isn't listening enough, isn't hearing those voices enough to pick up on those marginal stories and to tell them. So for me, that is the major challenge, that there is a disconnect. The traditional media continues to tell the story as it's always told, and the rest of the world is going on and engaging, and we are not engaging with their story. Yeah.
Let me turn to Marie from Tanzania. You're the chairperson of the Tanzanian Independent Producers Association. You're a program maker yourself. What are the challenges for you from that perspective? And of course, the Tanzanian media scene.
I do know in my country, a lot of people find it very complicated and they don't understand what it is. That is going to create, I think, a revolution on the part of content creation. Why? Because it's no longer going to be about who has got so many towers up and who's going to stake out a piece of the terrestrial bit, but it's going to be about having all those digital channels available, and they need content. People are going to be able on those set-top boxes to surf through several channels at the same time, and they want to see different type of content. So that is where we as independent producers are actually very optimistic about this, because we feel that this will create the opportunity for us to be finally recognized for what we do.
But I'd like to turn to you, Vivien. You're surrounded by broadcasters and content producers, but you're on the other side of the world. And what is that side of the world saying where the real people live? That's the audience.
Well, I think it's a very, very exciting time for the real people. Right now, I think that the power balance has completely shifted. In the past, the power, if you like, lay with the broadcasters. It was the broadcasters who determined what you were going to see and listen to, and when you were going to see and listen to it, and you had very little choice. Nowadays, that power balance has shifted into the hands of the end users, the participant audiences, shall we say, no longer the passive viewers and listeners, but the active participants. So the day of the audience, the day of the people, has arrived with digital media, with many of the attendant challenges that have, been raised.
You're calling this a cultural Tahrir moment, Tahrir Square moment.
I certainly am. And I think it is a very exciting change for each and every one of us. But I don't underestimate the fact that we're sitting today in the middle of a large East African capital city with media savvy people. There are many, many people across our region who are not as media savvy and who don't have access to the kinds of media technologies that we have. And one of the challenges of digitization is that there may be the haves and the have-nots with regard to access to and use of information. That we don't just get caught up in the hype that we're all blogging and we're all on Twitter and we're all on Facebook, because actually we're not. And we're certainly not across our region of East Africa.
I'd like you to come back to that in greater detail in a moment. But just a question to the rest of the panel. We touched about the real people, the audiences. What about us? Do we really understand when we talk about digital migration, digital media? What's the state of preparedness do we have? Salim?
I think it's a serious problem and something that should have been addressed a long time ago, where there should have been some sort of education process with the general public to inform them and educate them as to what this means to them and how this will change their lives.
I wonder what the experience is in the rest of East Africa, in Uganda. Are you in the dark and not as a result of power cuts?
I'm in the dark and going even darker There's no light at the end of the tunnel. I am with Salim on this. I have no clue what is going on. I understand the technology because I went to journalism school. That's about it. And nobody's is telling me what's what.
Tanzania, how ready are we, Maria?
First of all, personally, I understand a lot about it, but that's because I'm really interested in it. But I think overall, one of the biggest problems that exist is that there is actually a deadline for the cutoff. And the cutoff is gonna happen, whether we're ready or we're not ready. And that is what makes this scary. Because if from one day to the other, suddenly people are going to wake up and they're not going to be able to see their television sets, or it's not going to be working. That's going to create another crisis. And what I see is that right now, everybody in the media or in the broadcasting sector is busy staking out his or her place. And they're not engaging. I think that's what Vivien says. It's not engaging the audience. They're just among themselves squabbling like, I want to become a multiplex operator. I want to become a TV station. And that's what they're all caught up in, and the regulator as well. And they're not paying attention that people go out, they just see advertisements that you have to buy a set-top box. And they say, oh, is this like, if I'm allowed to say, is it like multi-choice? Or is this like something that is a cable TV? They don't understand that this is actually the free-to-air channel that's going to be switched off and you'll not be able to see. So that is what I think it has to become, like an alert out there and tell people, be aware.
That's quite scary because I earn a living from television. I need to be seen. Churchill, presumably this kind of confusion is good news for you because then it means people are engaged with you online because that's not affected.
I don't think so, because one thing that digital broadcasting will do is that it's going to converge the TV screen as we know it with the computer screen. So potentially, there are benefits that should accrue to me in terms of somebody who serves audiences through the online space. Because if that happens well, then those who today can only get free-to-air television come into the realm of the people I can potentially target.
Is that real or rather futuristic? Because I've heard sort of in Europe stories of, in future, your television will also be your screen. You'll be able to get, you know, sort of your plate will. Is that happening here? No.
Ladies and gentlemen, do you really know what analog means? Do you know what digital means? Do you know what free-to-air means? I mean, we ordinary people don't use this language, do we? It doesn't mean anything to us. Don't they just want to bamboozle us with all this techno-speak, with all this technology? Surely we want to watch programmes, listen to radio on any device we choose, don't we? We don't care, do we? Exactly. So I think the challenge is for us as the ordinary mortals to challenge the broadcasters, to challenge our governments, to demystify all this nonsense for us and just help us to continue to enjoy the media content that we choose to watch and listen to when we choose to listen to it.
Vivien, that's well put. For a moment, I was worried you're running for an office somewhere. But you're all storytellers. What are the challenges that these changes pose to you? I'll come to the opportunities in a moment, but what sort of challenges? I know, Rachel, you mentioned a few. What are the challenges that come to you as storytellers?
Our main business is content production and content aggregation and distribution. The challenge is reformatting all that content to put it into all these different mediums of distribution. There's your standard broadcasting. If it's video, your standard broadcasting model, the internet model for distribution, and mobile phones. All the content now has to be formatted in a way that people can watch mobile phones. While I agree with Vivien that not everybody will have access to Facebook or to a computer or a TV screen, most people have mobile phones on this continent, and more and more people will continue to have mobile phones and mobile access. We need to format our content in such a way that it can reach them at an affordable rate, and that they can enjoy it on their mobile phone. So that's one of our challenges.
A quick thought from you, Richard, before I move on.
Sure. For us, the challenge has always been producing good content that then we can sell. Because we find as independent news documentary magazine producers for radio in Uganda, not many people are willing to pay for good content. So regardless of how many voices we are capturing, how well developed our content is, few people are willing to pay. Not even the government funded, it says it's not government funded, it is, it's not a voice of the government, it is. Our government broadcaster is willing to pay a premium for good content. They, you know, would rather cope out. So in this age of online media, where it requires you to retrain, perhaps reinvest in this media, they're unwilling to do so. Rather play the same old, you know, music video day in, day out, Spanish opera day in, day out, than actually pay for good content.
We've been talking about real people on their behalf, and now we would like to give them a vote. So I'd like to hear some of the comments from the floor, some questions specifically on the challenges that you feel the whole migration to digital television, which means a lot and lots and lots of channels for you to watch. What does that actually mean for you?
On the issue of sources, we are migrating from traditional sources to digital sources. What is there for us to protect those digital sources? So that if I send an email, that email is not traced, given that the IP addresses are still largely owned by government, and therefore traditional whistleblowers are now being exposed to being found out by government.
But my concern is this, and this is what I want to say. Agreed, the digital revolution is unleashing tremendous opportunities, but who is benefiting ultimately? And another thing, when I look at the background behind digital revolution, that's Africa. Digital is the beginning and end of it is that digital revolution is going to change the way we consume media. And Africa is an audience end that has been on the receiving end. We are always affected negatively. Are we creating, Salim, a mentality of liberating the audience to be better participants? We do not want to think digital then if we can't benefit.
I'm just touching on something that Mr. Amin brought up earlier. It's to do with censorship. Should social media be censored, and how would you go about it if you believe that it should happen?
I believe the majority of people really don't know what this digital media is all about. For example, where I come from, a small town in Western, very many people really don't know much about this. So how are we going to make them know it?
There's been a lot thrown at you, Salim. I don't know why, fairly or unfairly.
My audience maybe loves me. All right, let me go backwards. I'll start with Samantha's comment on the censorship. Censorship is a dirty word. It's not a word that we've ever used. Something that we've always fought for, from my father's time right through to today, is about a free media. It's about telling Africa's stories. And telling them properly and honestly and in an unbiased way, and showcasing this continent for all its beauty and opportunity, as well as all the problems, but even those problems being told from an African perspective. But I do believe that there has to be a way to check information. I know enough people that believe what they read on Facebook and on Twitter as being the gospel truth, as much as they have seen it on Al Jazeera or on CNN or on the BBC. If they read that on Twitter and Facebook, they just spread it. And that is very dangerous. I think we have enough problems of perception and of misunderstandings on this continent that we don't need to have more of misinformation floating around. There's enough bad information going around that Edward here talked about, you know, the misrepresentation of our continent. And that is, it's already happening, and we're perpetuating this if we believe everything that we read. And so we need to have some sort of way to be able to, for people to go to another source or understand that if you read it on Facebook, you read it on Twitter, maybe check it with a credible news source. That could be Nation, it could be BBC, it could be India TV, whatever you think is credible in your mind that you have done the research on, use that to check it.
Maria.
I'm sorry, I don't agree with you. The reason is I don't think social media should be in any way controlled or censored. if we're talking about the image of Africa that is being, you know, misappropriated or there's misinformation out there, I think it is our duty to put that right. Social media, I'll give you a very good example. Social media is something that is very personal. I can tweet right now that I'm sitting here and I think that, you know, this audience is the best in the world. That's my opinion. Whether it is picked up because people, I have more followers on Twitter, or I have got more friends on Facebook, or whether it's picked up because somebody who is famous will pick it up, that does not mean that I should be blamed for giving my opinion or for putting out information there. It is very difficult to tell, and again, we're mystifying this, to say fact-checking. How many people know what even fact-checking is? They'll just see something and say, oh my God, I think I saw a police hanging on the building. It was not a police, they were filming, there was nothing, but they will create sort of a panic. So I think controlling in any way social media is, first of all, very difficult because it is viral. It will spread in seconds.
It's not about controlling social media. If you sat here and you said, you know, I just got a phone call that I was going to say, you know, our president has, something's happened to our president. And you decided, well, let me put that on Facebook. Mm-hmm. You know, something's happened to our president. Because you have so many followers, that message is going to go viral. Mm-hmm. And the chances are that, and he's absolutely fine. True. But that will go, and the problem is, let me put it from my media perspective, that someone at the nation, Churchill here, may pick that up and will print that. And it will go to the nation. Or I'm just using it as an example. I don't think you will do that, but I'm just using
you.
Yeah. But you know, because there is so many people that have believed it and have spread it, it automatically becomes the truth. And that's my concern. I'm not saying we should censor it. I'm not saying we should control it. I'm saying there should be a bit of responsibility on the part of the people that use social media to understand their power as well. We've always been accused as journalists of not understanding our power, of abusing the power that we have. That power is now in the hands of the people. And the people have to understand the responsibility that goes with that power, the same way that we've had to do that.
I've come to Rachel. Someone said it's very dangerous to give power to the people. But Rachel.
The traditional media doesn't always get it right. So when we're talking about fact-checking, I don't know. I often don't read that. Well, I'll be honest. I rarely buy the newspaper. I buy it on Monday to check for jobs. That's the truth. So I buy the New Vision and the East Africa, and then maybe somebody will tell me there's an advert in the... So I have absolutely no confidence, that's the truth, in the traditional media, because they've gotten it wrong so often. And so often, they're left behind. A simple example is, in 2009, we had an outbreak of... Well, tribal riots of some sort in Kampala. It didn't matter how long you waited, all day or all night. Nobody was broadcasting. The radio stations were silent. They were playing, you know, hip hop and I don't know what. And it was people on Twitter who got the word out. A lot of it may have been rumor, but at least it was out there. It was the people taking control of their circumstances and spreading news about it. I agree with Salim that there is a responsibility on when that news comes back to the media houses for them to check the facts.
Very quick comments before we go on a short break to Maria and then Vivien, you had something to say just briefly and we'll come back.
I just wanted to use the same example, a similar situation. Well, it was even more tragic. Actually, it was when the ammunition depot exploded in Dar es Salaam. Nobody knew what is happening. And there is a local social network called Yemi Forums, where they not only reported, they put up pictures, later it spread all the way to Twitter, there were sounds, they were filming how people were running. I mean, I honestly think that this is a wonderful thing to empower the people and to give them the ability to create content, and how we use it is another matter, but I don't think the responsibility of fact-checking, the responsibility of putting it right should be on the people. It has to be with us, and it continues to be with us who are the content.
Well, you're watching a special discussion program here at the National Museum of Kenya. We're looking at the digital revolution with the growth of social media, with the onset of migration from analog television to digital television. What does this mean for us as consumers of media content, as broadcasters, as media practitioners? We'll be right back with the discussion. Welcome back to the Digital Revolution. Well, a discussion of it here at the National Museum of Kenya in a special program brought to you by the Commonwealth Broadcasting Association. Now, earlier in the program, we heard a lot from the media, the content producers, on what they see as the future in terms of the rise of social media, the migration from analog to digital television. But what about the real people? The real people who consume these products, the real people who have to make these changes, what do they know? What do they make of it? Well, we sampled some opinions in Kibera, in Nairobi.
Everybody is talking about the digital world and the analog thing.
Analog, I think it's a very old mode of communicating.
What I understand from digital is basically electronic systems used through modern day computers, modern day digital watches. Analog systems are more or less, you know, amateurs which use systems, for example, not anything electronic in it.
I can't define analog and digital, but the thing I know is if you know computer, you're digital. If you don't know anything about computers, you are analog.
I first thought it was 2015, but now since it's 2012, I would say it's going to be a bit difficult because one, our government has not informed people about digital TV. As a matter of fact, I think they're very reluctant.
About it, I think there's a time I was just going through the newspapers and the Minister of Information, Tommy Pogisio, he was talking about the 2012, our TV stations are going to be digital.
Yeah, I'm aware of that, and it's very convenient. That's what I like here. I'm not a Kenyan, but I love the idea of having these things.
I actually didn't hear about it until now.
Personally, I was aware because I've met friends from like KBC who have told me that, but I think people don't really know.
No, I don't really support it because I don't understand it. It just doesn't make sense.
I support this in terms of viewers will have more control of the content, choose what they want to see. Other than the analog, what is presented to you is what you take in.
When you're using the digital, you can have many channels which are not only international, they are local and international. So I think I'm very supportive to that idea. We are in a country which is developing, so we have to show people we are developing really in sense of technology and in sense of economically.
If it was going to be switched off, it would be like switching off a big part of the country from viewing now TV.
For these digital systems, yeah, I don't think most people will be able to afford them, you know? They're really expensive, like for example the flat screen TVs, very expensive. People living in Kibera, Kongwari probably won't be able to afford these systems.
DSTV, it was like a taste of what you could actually have, and Kenyans appreciate that.
The only thing the government can do if they want to convert from analog to digital is make sure they reduce the prices of all these analog systems that they're gonna change to, so the average Kenyan can afford them.
Otherwise, there will be a big problem.
It's going to mess around with people's lives, but the end of it all, digital is for the benefit of your children, my children, their children to come.
It's a process. You take your time to introduce it. You don't just do it all of a sudden like they're doing it right now. So I think, yeah, do it slowly by slowly, let the people understand it, and then from then on, you can introduce it fully.